very good morning and welcome to Living Hope Methodist Church online service. It is so wonderful that you're able to join us today. Before we begin, let us reflect on the Word of God. Psalms chapter 18, verses 2 to 3 says, "The Lord is my rock, my fortress and my deliverer. My God is my rock, in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I called to the Lord, who is worthy of praise, and I have been saved from my enemies. Indeed, he is worthy of all our praise and adoration." So, let us now come together for a meaningful time of worship with the acts of praise.
You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit, we love. grace of God has reached for me and pulled me from a raging sea, and I am safe on this solid ground. The Lord is my salvation. I will not fear when darkness falls. His strength will help me scale these walls. I'll see the dawn of the rising sun. The Lord is my salvation.
Is my
unity. Why don't we sing a song of praise?
Greetings to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. A very good morning to all of you. I trust everyone is fine and okay in your various homes. We continue to stay focused and connected with our Lord Jesus Christ. And this morning, as I bring to you an item of prayer and intercession, let us continue to pray for the pandemic. We continue to seek God and ask for His mercy, cry out for His mercy. And we pray that this whole pandemic will come to an end. And God has His purpose. And we know God is sovereign. And He will make things, everything good in His perfect time. And so we want to pray and uphold many people that are going through this pandemic. One way or another, we all are affected. And so we want to pray and ask God for His mercy. Acts chapter 2, verse 21 says, "And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." I like what C.H. Spurgeon writes. He says this, "In the worst of time that can ever happen, salvation is still available. When day turns to night and life becomes death, when famine rules the land and the hope of man has fled, there still remains in God, in the person of His dear Son, deliverance to all who will call upon the name of the Lord. We do not know what is going to happen looking into the future, the dark things. Even so, this light will always shine between the clouds. Whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be delivered." Amen. Yes, friend, our hope is in the Lord Jesus Christ. Salvation belongs to Him. And we're thankful that we have Jesus as our Lord and Savior. And so, even this morning, as we lift up our voice in prayer together, corporately, wherever you are in your homes, let us pray and lift our nation unto the Lord, especially for deliverance over this pandemic. And come, let us pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your grace that is sufficient for all of us. We thank You for Your word says that whoever cries out to You, whoever calls upon Your name, they shall be delivered. And so, Lord, in the midst of all this pandemic that we are going through, salvation is still available for all of us. Salvation is available for those who choose to call upon Your name. And so this morning, Lord, we, your people, redeemed by Your blood, Jesus, we ask, oh Lord, today we call upon Your name, bring deliverance to our nation, bring deliverance to our family, to our people whom we know, our loved ones, friends who are going through and battling this pandemic, this COVID-19 virus. Lord, we ask for Your mercy, Lord. We can only cry out for Your mercy. The more we go through, the more we cry out for Your mercy. So, Lord, have mercy upon our land. Have mercy upon our people. Have mercy upon those who are sick, those who have contracted COVID-19. Lord, have mercy, Lord. And we continue to repent on behalf of our land. We continue to ask for Your forgiveness for our land. Lord, we have done many things. Our leaders, our past leaders, have done many things that are wrong. We ask of Your forgiveness. Lord, have mercy upon our land, Malaysia. Lord, see upon our land as Your apple of the eye. We're precious to You. And so we pray, Lord, even right now, may intervene into the circumstances of our people who are suffering, whether in the hospital, still recovering, whether they are in the ICU, battling over their life. Lord, have mercy, Lord. We pray for our loved ones. We ask for Your continued protection over them. We pray, Lord, that this all cases, the infectivity rate will flatten. And we ask, Lord, as the increase in the vaccination, Lord, there will be reduction in cases. Lord, have mercy upon our land. We pray for the revival of our economy. People who have not lost their job, people who have lost their job, people who have gone through, Lord, difficulties and pain in this time. Lord, restore them, revive our economy, revive, oh Lord, every part of our life and being. So help us, oh Lord, even right now. We pray for your mercy and we ask of you, Lord, that we will continue to live up to your name. We will continue to look to you for help. And Lord, we pray that one thing we desire, Lord, is to worship you, is to live up your name. One thing we desire, Lord, is to gaze at the beauty of your face. One thing we desire, Lord, that you would dwell with us among your people. And so, Lord, we pray, we thank you for this morning, the privilege of prayer. Lord, a privilege that we can come before you. And so we thank you, we bless you. We pray that as we hear your word spoken, we pray that we will once again, Lord, our spirit man will be able to connect with yours and your word will bring healing and restoration for all of us. So we thank you, we bless you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, the offerings and pledges to LHMC can be made via online bank transfer to the bank account stated on this slide. Kindly indicate offering or pledge to treasurer at livinghopemc.com. God bless.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
A very good morning to all of you in Living Hope Methodist Church who's watching this right now online this morning. And I'm blessed and privileged to be given this opportunity to share with you a message. So I'm also honored. I feel honored, and I praise God that God is using me as his instrument this morning to deliver a lesson to all of us, a lesson to myself as well. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this privilege of delivering your message. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable to thee, O Lord, my rock and my salvation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As I studied this, Deuteronomy chapter 23, verses 1 to 7, a number of things came to my mind. God has given me, allowed me to have different ideas, but I prayed about it. And as I prayed about it, I realized that I had many questions. Many questions came to my mind concerning the laws and regulations in Deuteronomy. So I was thinking much about it. So I realized that the laws and regulations was definitely there to assist the society, the community, who is just left Egypt and moving into the land of Canaan. The Israelites, now a nation moving into the land of Canaan, they needed some kind of law and order to establish a system, a civilization. So when that, during that time, as that happens, when I read through Deuteronomy chapter 22 to 25, for example, I realized there's all these different laws that God has instituted for marriage, for relationships, for understanding how to treat others as well. So I was quite, it took me a while. I had some difficulties trying to understand how this works. I realized I was too focused on each one of it. Then when I stepped back, I saw the bigger picture. Then I realized it's a grand design. So the title of our message this morning is God's Design Principles. God's Design Principles, God's Grand Design. And in his grand design, God uses his principles, his precepts, his laws, his statutes. God uses these principles to establish a design that can shape us into the instruments and designs that he wants us to be. So what is God's design principles, or what is the word design? The word design is really about putting in the ingredients together into a good composition, like a nice, delicious dish or a wonderful creation. Isn't that interesting? Because I come from the background of design. I am with the design school now, and I teach design. I've been teaching this for many years, and I've also done some design work. I've witnessed as well designers, how they do their work as well. And it takes a lot of work. The process is really meticulous, and people don't often talk about it, because you often see the design, you often look at any kind of designs, and you use them, but no one really sees what really happens in the background. Do you know, if you watch cartoons, for example, Children love cartoons. I love cartoons. I'm sure some of you like to watch some animation, like you see those 3D animation in the movies, on television. Do you know how many drawings was done to create just 1 minute worth of animation? Just for 1 minute worth of animation, it can come up to hundreds of drawings. Yes. Sometimes, so can you imagine those days before all this technology, they had to literally draw on papers. They draw paper after paper, then they take snapshots of it. They use cameras. It's a meticulous work. It will take months, sometimes years, to create a full feature length animation. Today, even with the technology, digital technology, it takes a long, long time. And it's so meticulous. And they use specific instruments, pencil, paintbrushes. So it requires a lot of discipline as well. There's so much discipline that goes into creating something. So who is the designer? The designer is the one who plans, the one who shapes things, who plans to try to create something, to make something into real, something into something that is usable. So every instrument needs to be useful. Every instrument, as you can see, it's important for them to be in good condition, right? They have to be in good condition so that you can produce quality work. So whatever that you're wearing is functional. Whatever that you buy is worth its value. So God is a designer, and we are His design and His design instruments. So as I said, the instruments have to be in good condition. Now, as His design instruments, we become these instruments because God wants us to do the designing as well. Now, in order to do that, we need to be instruments in very good condition. Quality instruments, right? One of the most powerful quality instrumentation that we have is prayer. We are instruments of prayer. So we become these instruments in the design of a society after God's heart. So what does it take to be God's effective design instrument? Now, the laws and regulations of Deuteronomy are divine design principles. These are principles, design principles, which only comes from the master designer himself, God, our Yahweh. Now, these principles are not created by us. They are created by God. I mean, look at the environment around you. Everything is so well created. If you look at the trees, the nature around us, the flowers, the grass of the field, just as Jesus said, God's design is just so perfect. How is it so perfect? Because of God's design principles. God's principles makes it perfect. God's principles makes it special and unique. Every single thing in nature, how small, no matter how small and how big, they are so perfect. The universe itself, and God created it, is so perfect. Everything is perfectly in place. You can see the earth is third from the sun, and it's highly inconceivable. You can never imagine seeing Earth on the same orbit of another planet. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here. We are existing because of God's divine design principles. Because God, as the master designer, He knew how to put everything in place. He knew how to put all the ingredients in place. So now that we establish this, God is the master designer. How do we see this? How do you see the scriptures that describe God as the master designer? And one interesting part of that is today's chapter, Deuteronomy 20, chapter 23, verses 1 to 7. Let's read this right now. Verse 1, no one who has been emasculated by crushing or cutting may enter the assembly of the Lord. Now, as I've said, every instrument that you use has to be perfect. It has to be in good condition. Verse 1 clearly states here, now if you want to get into the presence of God, verse 1 says, no one who has been emasculated by crushing or cutting may enter the assembly of the Lord. Verse 2, no one born of a forbidden marriage, nor any of their descendants may enter the assembly of the Lord, not even in the 10th generation. If there's corruption in some kind of historical corruption as well, some kind of bad relationships or bad marriage, illegitimate marriage, things like that. Something illegitimate, something that's against the law was done, even historically, you are not allowed to come before the assembly of the Lord. And verse 1 states in a very special way, by emasculated, by crushing or cutting, it means that this refers to eunuchs. This refers to eunuchs. Eunuchs, the idea of eunuchs come from pagan understanding, pagan tribes. So these eunuchs, they're not approved by God. God does not approve that, because God always sees men as the seed of the next generation. So in this case, eunuchs are not approved. God does not approve them. So they're not allowed to be in the presence of God. You can't bring broken instruments into God's presence. So these are broken instruments. God can't use these instruments to be part of his design. Let's go back to Deuteronomy chapter 23. Verse 3, no Ammonite or Moabite or any of their descendants may enter the assembly of the Lord, not even in the 10th generation. For they did not come to meet you with bread and water on your way when you came out of Egypt. And they hired Balaam, son of Beor from Pethor in Aram Naharaim, to pronounce a curse on you. However, the Lord your God will not listen to Balaam, but turned the curse into a blessing for you, because the Lord your God loves you. God loves his children, the Israelites. Do not seek a treaty of friendship with them as long as you live. Now, who are the Ammonite and the Moabite? They are descendants of Lot, because Lot's daughters, they're descendants of incest. They were products of incest. So they were forbidden groups. They were enemies of the Israelites because of that. They were corrupted. These are corrupt group of people. They're corrupted by genetically. They were born out of incest. And then their descendants are the Ammonite and the Moabite. So they have been the enemies. So it clearly states no Ammonite or Moabite or any of their descendants may enter the assembly of the Lord, not even in the 10th generation. So that's very, very clear. And furthermore, they did not even help the children of Israel when the Israelites came out of Egypt and they were moving into the land of Canaan. They didn't even help. They were so angry. It's like, oh my gosh. They were really upset. They were upset. They said, my goodness, I don't like this group of people. They shouldn't be here. Let's call Balaam. No, Balaam is actually something like, some say he was like a sorcerer. So some say he's a false prophet. But Balaam was quite a popular person in that respect, because he's able to pronounce curses. So they hired him to pronounce curses on the children of Israel. But the children of Israel is already part of God's plan, God's design. So if somebody want to ruin your artwork, would you allow them to do it? Of course you won't. So the same way, the Lord did not listen to Balaam. He turned the curse into a blessing. However, the Lord your God will not listen to Balaam, but turn the curse into a blessing because God loves his artwork. God loves the children of Israel. They are his artwork. He's designing them. They are work in progress. So the children of Israel is God's work in progress, and we are his children. We are also work in progress. Do you think God will let anyone ruin his artwork? Absolutely not. Then verse 7, do not despise an Edomite, for the Edomites are related to you. Do not despise an Egyptian, because you resided as foreigners in their country. The third generation of children born to them may enter the assembly of the Lord. Now, historical hatred also exists during that time. There was a lot of historical hatred with the Edomites. They were descendants of Esau. And Esau, as you know, they're all related to Israel, because Esau is a brother of Jacob. So, but somehow there are grudges. So there's always grudges between the Edomites and the Israelites. Hatred can be deep, but forgiveness is a key to restoration. So he says, don't despise them, because find a way to accept them. Because at one point you were also, they granted you hospitality. The same way can be said about Egyptians. Egyptians especially granted the Israelites hospitality. Well, eventually it became something else and then left Egypt. But for 400 years, they resided in Egypt. So the Egyptians provided a home, and in appreciation, God appreciates everything. Everything anyone does, any good things does, anyone does for the Israelites, for his children, God appreciates. God will bless them. God says, don't despise them. Don't look down on them. Don't look down on this people group. Because they have been good to you. If they are good to you, they are good to me. And they have taken care of my artwork. There's a lot that can be said in these verses, but I want to touch on two main principles that God uses to make sure that the children of Israel are not just instruments of perfection. God doesn't want the children of Israel to be only instruments of perfection. Because you see, the verses talk about perfection. Talk about purity. And talks about justice and balance. So there are two main principles that God works with. The principles of purity in Deuteronomy verses 1 and 2. Because God wants perfection. God does not want any dirt and blemish. God doesn't want uncleanness to be in his presence. Not even in the historical side. Not even illegitimate marriages. If you're illegitimate children as well are not allowed in there. Doesn't matter what the circumstances were. It's not pure. So that is very clear. Purity. Then the principles of justice and balance. Deuteronomy chapter 23 verses 3 to 7. But something else is at work here. God also restores. The principles of purity is not just in the physical. The principles of purity, for example, let's go back to the artwork. Now, if you want, if God wants you to create a wonderful new artwork, you need to, your instruments must not be broken. Your instruments must be in very good condition. Just like the principles of purity, Deuteronomy chapter 1 and 2, you cannot be broken. You cannot be a broken person. You eunuchs are not allowed. So, just like this, like a broken paint, you can't use a broken paintbrush or broken pencil to, and a, or a contaminated paint like that to create an artwork. God doesn't use broken instruments to create an artwork. So that is, there's always a very big risk when God wants to create use broken instruments to create an artwork, because it will destroy the artwork. The artwork will be corrupt. The artwork will be dirty. The artwork will not fulfill the design of God. How does this restoration work then? Isaiah chapter 56 verses 3 to 6 says, "Don't let foreigners who commit themselves to the Lord say, 'The Lord will never let me be part of his people.' And don't let the eunuch say, 'I'm a dried up tree with no children and no future.' For this is what the Lord says: I will bless those eunuchs who keep my Sabbath holy and who choose to do what pleases me and commit their lives to me. I will give them within the walls of my house a memorial and a name far greater than sons and daughters could give, for the name I give them is an everlasting one, and it will never disappear." Amen. Look at that. Look at that. Look at the promise that God gives. Verse 3 itself says, "Don't let foreigners who commit themselves to the Lord say, 'The Lord will never let me be part of his people.'" That's proof that God restores. Isn't that wonderful, brothers and sisters? That is really wonderful. It gives a lot of hope. So the principles of purity is not just about being perfect and being unblemished in the physical, but it's also the spiritual. The restoration that takes place is a spiritual. So God doesn't keep that. God doesn't say, I'll destroy them, you know, just because they're not qualified to be in the assembly of the Lord, just because they are this way. But God says, nevertheless, if you submit to me, if you surrender yourself to me, if you seek me with all your heart, I will restore you. I'll bring you back. I will fix you. And if you notice that in the principles of justice and balance, the Ammonites and the Moabites, who were they? They were basically corrupt group of people, because they were children of descendants of incest, right? So, and we were told not to seek a treaty of friendship with them as long as you live. Do not despise an Edomite, and so on. But we're focusing on Ammonite. Who are they? Who are the Ammonite and the Moabites? They may be rejected. They may be totally rejected. But eventually, God restored a Moabite. Eventually, God brought about a huge change through one Moabite. And her name is Ruth. And that's, if you look at the book of Ruth, you see the story of Ruth. The restoration that happened was the restoration of a family through the marriage of Boaz and Ruth. Now, Ruth, a Moabite, made the decision to be loyal to Naomi, who's also an Israelite. And also, in this case, because of her loyalty to Naomi, during the tough times, she was also loyal to God. And she pledged her loyalty to God by being loyal to Naomi as well. And that became an inspiration to Boaz. Boaz was so inspired, and Boaz married her, which secured a family's future and became one of five women mentioned in the genealogy of Jesus Christ. You see, Ruth's decision to decide to be loyal to God brought her back, brought about restoration. So she's a Moabite, and you know, people might see a Moabite, Boaz, although he was betrothed to her, there was another relative who also qualifies to be betrothed to her, but when he found out she was a Moabite, nope. So that's the thing about, you know, certain people, when you look down on them, you know, you think that they are often this group of people, you know, it's like this stereotype, you know, this group of people. We constantly look down on them, and we constantly have this prejudicial and stereotypical thoughts. And even from verses 6 and 7, you can see again, not just the Ammonites and the Moabites, we see lots of prejudice happening in today's world as well. But see, God restores. God restores through the principles of justice and balance. There's justice. God brought justice to Ruth. God brought justice to a Moabite, because of all the years that she and her people have been seen this way, but God brought about that for her. Now, you can see this parallel happening in today's society in everywhere. You can see that justice comes in many forms. These principles of justice and balance is crucial. It's very crucial to ensure that God's design will last forever. So you see the interesting thing about how God creates, how God plans an artwork, and how God's plans his design. The principles of purity and justice and balance is really about the spiritual restoration. You know, come to think of it, it's not about destroying, it's not about casting away a group of people. It doesn't work like that. But God is a good God. God is a loving God. I mean, you see in Deuteronomy verses 5, the Lord God will not listen to Balaam but turn the curse into a blessing for you, because the Lord your God loves you. God loves you. God loves what he creates. God does not hate what he creates. God loves you. The only exception we can see that God was sorry about his creation was in the time of Noah. But the corruption of creation at that time was unprecedented. But Jesus warned us about corruption, but corruption in the spiritual. Corruption in the spiritual. Do not forget that if you want to be part of God's design, you need to surrender not just the physical, but you got to surrender the spiritual, the heart, and you got to surrender the mind. But we have help from Jesus, because the good and important and the most exciting thing that we understand as well is that God himself is involved in his design. So how do we see that happening? God creates beautiful artworks. You are God's artwork. So in this case, when God restores, you can be instruments for his design. Whatever that's been broken or corrupted or tainted can be restored. Can be restored, and then you can produce beautiful work. You can be works of art. And you can create works of art. You become the instruments that God can use to create beautiful things and make believers out of nations. God's principles are meant to restore and heal. So it does take time. There's a lot of debate about how, why should we hate, should we not hate, should we, you know, should we be angry about certain things? But yes, it's okay to be angry, but it has to be in the right place. We need to pray and ask God to show us how does he want us to be in his grand design. The laws and regulations that God put in our hearts in the book of Deuteronomy, it's not about telling us what to do and what not to do. It's actually showing us how eventually restoration can happen, how healing can happen. It's not about God saying you are not worthy. It's about God saying you are holy. So do not forget that. It's God's way of saying we are special. It's God's way of saying he loves us. He loves us just as he loves his beautiful artwork. We are part of his beautiful artwork. How does this two principles work in the post-pandemic world today? As I've said, we become the light and salt in the community today. How can we become the instruments? We become instruments for his design. We become instruments that he can use. So ask yourself, are you a broken instrument? If you are, don't worry. And the way I see it, we are not broken instruments anymore. None of us. The moment we receive Jesus Christ in our hearts, we are being fixed. As I've said, it takes time. It takes a long time to get everything in perfect order. But God is already using us. And you know what's a beautiful thing that holds us together is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit makes it work. And that's the most remarkable, miraculous thing that happens in our lives. We think we are broken. Only we think. We may be physically different. And you think you're broken because of the physical? Think again. Spiritually, you're beautiful because of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit makes us perfect inside. Just have to surrender to him. We just have to surrender to him. And God can use you as a channel, that as an instrument to help others, to create other beautiful, to restore other beautiful instruments, to restore instruments of a beautiful artwork. And you yourself can create artworks. And you become part of God's beautiful design. And that's exactly what's happening today. In conclusion, how does God's principles apply to us in today's world? What decisions would we make as God's designers in the making? These are some of the questions that we can ask ourselves. I would like to end this message with a story. Once upon a time, there was this brown squirrel. One day, the brown squirrel hopped along looking for a shelter. It saw a nice tree, and the brown squirrel sit to the tree. The brown squirrel spoke to the tree, and it asked the tree, "Can I make my home inside you?" After the tree heard it, it pondered and replied, "No, I don't think so. I don't think I want you to make your home inside of me. My body is only for my kind." Then the squirrel begged, "I promise I will take care of you, prune your leaves, give you food to eat, water to drink. Please let me make my home inside you," pleaded the squirrel. With a great sigh, the tree replied, "I'm very sorry, no can do. Please find another tree. Please go now. Do not disturb my slumber." Then the brown squirrel was rejected. The brown squirrel felt rejected, but it never gave up finding another tree would allow it to make its home on it. So months passed, brown squirrel kept looking, never really found one. And one day, some lumberjacks wanted to chop down a tree, and they noticed a large and beautiful tree. So they were about to cut it down when suddenly the brown squirrel appeared out of its hole in the tree trunk. Then when the lumberjacks saw it, they decided not to chop it down because the squirrel's home is inside. Said, "We're not going to harm any squirrel in a tree. You see, the squirrel found the tree to reside in. That tree gave it shelter. So the lumberjacks, however, noticed another tree. That's the tree the squirrel met earlier. Now, it was also as beautiful, but it was in distress, you know. So it called out the squirrel in desperation. He said, "Oh, squirrel, remember me? Please help me. Come make your home in me, or they will cut me down. Please, I beg you." And then the squirrel felt bad for the tree, but yet committed to its own tree. Then the squirrel said, "I'm sorry. I can't leave my home. You had your chance before, but it's too late now. I can't just leave." So at that, the squirrel went back into its hole and stayed inside the tree safely and peacefully. Now, as for the tree who rejected the brown squirrel, it was cut down, and that was the end of its life. Now, this story always reminded me, I wrote this story because of the brown squirrel is a representation. The brown squirrel represents people, individuals, anyone who felt rejected. And the tree that rejected the brown squirrel represented those who looked down on other people. You know, we have prejudice. If they were racist, you know, they have preconceived ideas about a people group. And that's so much pride, you know. So that tree represented that. And the tree that gave the squirrel its home are the trees of God's design. Because they're the ones all around the place who would provide shelter. So the squirrel felt safe there and felt loyal and committed to that tree. So, brothers and sisters, I hope this message has communicated something very beneficial to you and useful for you, for all of you. It was certainly useful for me studying this message. And I'm sorry if I fumbled a little bit at some points, but it's very clear that God has, in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 23, verses 1 to 7, God has clearly shown me and shown us that restoration does happen. God put his laws to not just create regulations, but is to shape us into a beautiful design. It is to shape us into a restored people. People who constantly seek him. People who constantly use his guidance, surrender to him. And that's the beautiful design of God. And one of the most powerful instruments that God has given us is prayer. So, thank you very much. We shall end this with a prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for allowing us to be part of your grand design. Thank you for being a designer that is perfect. Thank you for being a designer who has not rejected anything, who has included everything in the design. Because you can restore everything else. You can restore everything that is broken. You can restore everything that needs fixing. And you are using us to provide this restoration. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that in these troubled times, in these challenging times, you are always there to assure us and to strengthen us. So Lord, as we face the coming week, grant us the courage, Lord, to seek you, to seek your guidance, to constantly pray, and Lord, to always seek your word as well. And Lord, thank you for always walking with us. We surrender to you, Lord. Surrender our concerns. We surrender the coming week and weeks. We surrender our jobs. Surrender our difficulties. We surrender our families, those who are sick, those who are worried. We surrender all unto you. We pray all this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you, and God bless you. Have a wonderful week ahead.
And thou with me, Lord. Thou my great Father, I thy true Son, Thou in me dwelling, and I with thee one. Riches I heed not, nor man's empty gain. Thou mine inheritance, now and always. Thou and thou only, first in my heart. High King of heaven, my treasure thou art.
Let us pray. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you his perfect peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Have a blessed week ahead, church. Stay safe and stay connected with our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.